Good evening. It's good to see everyone out this evening. Our first song will be "By Faith I Can See." We'll sing the first and third verse of the song. So, by faith I can see the birth of my Savior, in a manger was He. God sent Him for me, the gift of God's love, to save poor lost sinners. What a gift from above. Our God is true love. I faith I can see. Opening prayer this evening will be led by Brother Adam Ragland. Before he comes and leads us in prayer, we'll sing the first and third verse of number 189, "Master, the Tempest is Raging." Do me so. Master, the tempest is raging, the billows are tossing high, the sky is Amen.
Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for the beauty of today. We thank you for what this day represents in our lives. Father, we're so grateful for Jesus and for his death, his burial, and Father, most importantly, his resurrection. Father, what a great day it is today to celebrate you, to be here together. Father, to sing and to meditate on your word. Father, to pray together. Father, how glorious it is to hear these children crying, and Father, to see the new growth of this congregation. Father, with that, we're also saddened at times for those that pass on. Father, there are many, many on the list today that are sick and ailing and hurting and have a lot of physical needs and emotional needs. And Father, may we not forget them. Father, we know that your hand is upon them. We thank you for that. Father, tonight is a special night that we get to listen to these young people proclaim your word. Father, we know as adults that the world that we live in is really pressing upon us. And Father, it's unbelievable the temptation that these young people are in today. But Father, it's so encouraging to see them proclaim your name from the pulpit. Father, to see each of these young men lead singing and to see these children perform in a way, God, that they love you. They, Father, stand before us and they sing songs that praise your name. And Father, we see the growth in these young people. We see that they are trying desperately, Lord, to stand for you in the school system, as difficult as that is. Father, we ask that you protect them, that you keep Satan away from them, that you plant other children that love you and that proclaim your name around them, that they can have strength in numbers. Father, we pray as parents, as we're raising these kids, and sometimes our adult kids, as stressful as it is, God, that you just help us to take a step back and know that you're holding them, that you love them deeply. Remind us, Father, of just the goodness in each other. Father, we ask that you bless the LADS program that this weekend as we go up to Nashville. It's so refreshing to see thousands and thousands of people that stand for you. Father, it's a beautiful reminder of what we believe heaven to be like. And Father, we just pray that you continue to bless that, continue to create leaders among leaders of young people that will go on, Father, to preach the gospel, to be missionaries. Father, we ask that you help us to encourage them, help us to help them financially. Father, help us to be aware that your hand is upon them and that you're for them and that we need to be for them and we need to help make a way. And Father, we thank you for Christian education. And Father, I pray that you give each one of us tonight a mindset and a heart that we would pay attention, that we would be in the right frame of mind, that we would have nothing else upon our heart or our mind but worshiping you tonight. And Father, we are grateful again for the time that you give us, something that we can't buy, that we will make the most of today, that we would not think about tomorrow, but just really focus on what we can do today to make a difference in people's lives. It's in Jesus Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Our song of encouragement this evening after Ben's lesson will be number 552, Have Thine Own Way, and we'll sing all four verses of that song. Before Ben comes and delivers his message this evening, we'll sing number 286, Wonderful Story of Love. If it's convenient for you, let's stand together as we sing. Wonderful story of love, tell it to me again. Wonderful story of love, wake me in heart astray. Angels in rapture announcing, shepherds with
everyone. Moves up, I want to have the mind, and you want to have the mind of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we make it our aim every day to glorify, to honor, and to magnify Him with our life. A big part of us doing that is viewing the Scriptures the way Jesus viewed the Scripture. How did Jesus view what we think of as Scripture? What was His mindset about the Word of God? And how did He look at that? And how did it govern and dictate what our Lord thought and what He did? That's what I want us to consider for our lesson tonight. And I hope you've got a Bible handy. If not, there'll be one there on the pew with you. We're going to look at 8 or 9 passages tonight that give us a pretty clear insight into how Jesus looked at the Scripture, the Word of God, and His mindset about them. If you would, please take your New Testament and open to Matthew chapter 22. As Jesus teaches us His view of the Scripture, we learn from Matthew 22, verse 49, that Jesus, He viewed the Scripture as a divine product, not a product of man. Look with me in Matthew 22, and I want you to see the context beginning in verse number 41. Matthew 22, verse number 41. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" They said to him, "The son of David." Now watch Jesus' response. He said to them, "How then does David in the Spirit call him Lord, saying, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool'?" If David calls him Lord, how is he his son? And so the whole argument Jesus is making is, you see him as the son of David. David saw him as Lord, as master, owner, creator. How can he be the son of David if he's also the Lord of David? And there's a whole beautiful teaching there. But look at what is said. Look at Jesus' view of Scripture in verse 43. "How then does David," listen to these words, "in the Spirit call him Lord?" What does that phrase, "David in the Spirit," mean? A friend, it means that David was under the guidance, that David's words were the product of the Holy Spirit, that David didn't think it up or make it up himself, that Jesus believed that David in the Scripture, when he spoke, was speaking by the Spirit of God. Friend, if I want to have a correct view, a view that Jesus had of the Word of God, I need to realize that the Bible is not a product of man's ideas, a product of man's imagination, but Jesus viewed the Scripture and those who spoke the Scripture as being under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Of course, you're familiar with some of these passages. Hold your finger here and look in 2 Peter chapter 1. We also, the New Testament teaches, and if I'm going to have the right view of Scripture, I need to realize it is a product of God, not of men. 2 Peter chapter 1. Look at verse 20 and 21. Peter said, "Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation." Some words and wordings there. You may have a footnote in your Bible next to interpretation. Probably a really good rendering of that would be origin. The Scripture is not of private origin, meaning when Mark or John or the Apostle Paul received the message of God. That message then was not filtered. Paul didn't take that message and say, okay, I understand the sense of it. Let me take it here and put it in words that I think it ought. No, it's not of private origin, private interpretation. It is the product of God. What do we mean by that? Verse 21. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Friend, if I want to have the view of Scripture that Jesus had, I need to realize when Matthew wrote, and when Paul wrote, and when James wrote, and when the Apostle John wrote, what they said by the Spirit of God. If David in the Spirit says, and we also learn that the New Testament is given by the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, a correct view, like Jesus, of Scripture is, this is from God's Spirit. Jesus promised the Spirit would come, that He would guide them all into all truth. We have that truth today in the Word of God. And so here's how that shapes my thinking, shapes my view of Scripture. When I open this book, friend, I don't look at this as some good guidelines. I don't read this as probably the best approach. When I open this book is the Spirit of God speaking to me. This is God's product. This is God's communication. These are not just the ideas and teachings of men. All right, a second view that Jesus had of Scripture. Open to Matthew chapter 5. And I want to invite you to look in verses 17 and 18. Jesus believed that the Scriptures were going to be fulfilled and that they were complete. And it was what man needed. Complete and full. Matthew 5. Look at the words of Jesus in verse 17 and 18. Jesus says, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away," listen to this, "one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled." And so Jesus' intention, when Jesus came to the earth, when Jesus spoke, when Jesus, and you can imagine this in the Jewish mindset, when Jesus broke down that middle wall of separation, the old law, the Ten Commandments, it wasn't as though Jesus came with a sledgehammer to destroy that. The reason Jesus was able to abolish that is because He fulfilled it completely. And it was full and complete, and it was time for His new law to be given. But friend, as you think about His mindset here, look at what it says again in verse 18. This is how Jesus felt about the Scripture. "Till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass away from the law." How did He view it? Jesus viewed the Scripture as complete. I want you to think about that phraseology, one jot or one tittle. In the Greek or even in the Hebrew language, this is the smallest pen stroke. In our way of thinking, it is the dotting of the I, just the smallest dot a pencil could make. It is the breathing mark, it's the accent that would sometimes go along with the smallest, most minuscule, sometimes even what we think of as obscure of the pen stroke. Jesus said not even one of those is going to pass away until all has been fulfilled. And so Jesus viewed the Bible as complete, as full. Parallel passage, 2 Peter chapter 1, open to verse number 3. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 3. As I approach the Bible with the same view of Jesus, this is what we're talking about tonight. 2 Peter 1. I want to invite you to look in verse number 3. And the Bible says, as God's divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by glory and virtue. It's like 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture is inspired of God and is complete. God's given us everything we need for life and for godliness. And so as we talk about our view of Scripture, not only do I want to realize this is the divine product of God, but friend, I also, when I have the mindset of Jesus as it pertains to the Bible, the Word of God, I realize Jesus believed this is all I needed. Jesus taught this was everything I needed to please God. Jesus believed that everything said in here would be full and fulfilled, that it would be completed, and that this is my guidebook in everything for life, life and godliness. And so here's how that changes my view. Friend, when matters of life come up, when questions of a religious nature come up, when I think about how I need to live or what I need to do, friend, if I believe this book, it's full and complete, you know what I also believe? It has the answer. It helps me with every challenge and problem that I might face. All right, a third passage. Open your Bible to John chapter 10, verse number 35. A third view that our Lord had about the Scriptures. Jesus believed the Scriptures settled the matter finally and ultimately. John chapter 10. I want you to look at the complaint by the Jews in verse 33, and I want you to watch what Jesus does to answer that and what He says about the Scriptures. John 10, verse 33. Here's the complaint. The Jews answered, Jesus said, by the way, for which of the good works that I've done do you want to stone me? Now watch their response. For a good work, we don't stone you. But, they said, for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself God. Jesus answered them. And then He quotes Psalm 82, verse 6 in His answer. Is it not written in your law, I said, you are gods? If He called them gods, to whom the Word of God came, now listen to this, and the Scripture cannot be broken, do you say of Him whom the Father sanctified and sent into the world, you're blaspheming because you said, I am the Son of God? And so Jesus' whole argument is this. You want to take me out, and you want to stone me, and you want to accuse me of blasphemy because I said, I am the Son of God. And yet in your own Scriptures, it says in Psalm 82, 6, He said, you are gods. And of course, that's used in the small capitalization, if we want to think that way. But Jesus said, this is not the first time somebody else has been referred to in that language. And He said, if it says that about those people, and you want to stone me about that, don't you see the Scripture cannot be broken? Jesus' point is, the Scripture is against what you're saying here. You cannot take that position because the Scripture actually condones the position I'm holding, and that settles the matter. When Jesus says the Scripture cannot be broken, friend, He's saying this. This is what the Bible says right here. In black and white, in plain truth, as clear as day, and it settles that matter. You can't use that whole blasphemy argument against me, because this is not the first time that language has been used of a human being in the Bible. And so when we think about this idea, friend, I'm reminded of the Bible's a power to answer questions. If I'm going to view the Scripture correctly, I'm going to view it this way. When we ask religious questions, when we talk about doctrinal matters, when we look at what the Bible says on an issue, friend, when we see what the Bible says, that settles it. The Scripture cannot be broken. What's that mean? The Scripture's not going to lie. The Scripture has the answer, and that answer in the mindset of Jesus was the final and ultimate answer on all matters. And so that changes my view in this way. Regardless of what society says, regardless of what popular opinion says, regardless of what any other human being says, when the Bible says it, that settles it forever. Psalm 119, verse number 89, "Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven." God's decided the matter. We simply need to look and see what God says. Number four, fourth view Jesus had. Jesus believed the Scripture. His view of Scripture was it was relevant to today's challenges, today's problems, and today's difficulties. How do I know that? Look in Matthew chapter 4. Jesus believed. You know, Hebrews 4:12 says this. The Word of God. Flip over to Matthew 4 as I remind you of this passage. Jesus said the Word of God is living and powerful. When the Bible says it's living, that's the idea that it is relevant, it is practical, that it relates to today's problems as well as problems in the first century. And Jesus shows us that. Matthew chapter 4. Jesus has been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. He is, you no doubt, hungry. He's been there out in the wilderness with the wild beast. It was a very difficult time in his life. And now the tempter comes to him. Okay? And so if you haven't eaten anything of substance, really, for 40 days and 40 nights, you're going to be really, really hungry, right? And so Satan comes to him and says, if here is third class conditional, possible but not likely. If you're the Son of God, turn these stones to bread. If you're the Son of God, cast yourself down from the pinnacle of the temple. The Bible says God will give his angels charge over you. If you're the Son of God, Satan will go on to tempt him with all these temptations that Jesus would be tempted by. And look at how Jesus responded every time. Matthew 4:4, Matthew 4:7, and Matthew 4, verse 10. Jesus said, "It is written." And then he'll quote a Bible verse, many of those from the book of Deuteronomy. What was Jesus' view of Scripture? Jesus believed what Psalm 119, verses 10 through 12 says. "Your word I've hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you." Friend, our Lord believed. He lived it, he believed it, and he showed it. That when challenges arise, when you are tempted by whatever your temptation is, when challenges arise that we've got to face, I learned from Jesus right here that he believed the Scriptures were relevant, practical, and alive. That they could be used and inserted in my life and yours tomorrow. Friend, if I really believe that, this week, as I face various challenges, this week, as we are all tempted by the tempter, let's remember, if our Lord viewed the Scripture as that relevant and practical, when I face that temptation, you know what I need to do? I need to stop and ask myself, what does the Scripture say about this? How would Jesus address, what Bible verses can help me with this problem? I think that's a great view of Scripture that our Lord had. All right, how else did Jesus view the Scripture? Jesus viewed them as historically right. Open your Bible to a couple of passages with me. Matthew chapter 12. Jesus viewed the Bible, the Scripture, the Word of God as aligning perfectly with history. Matthew chapter 12. Look, if you would, beginning in verse number 30. Let's read beginning in verse 38. "Then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered him, saying, 'Teacher, we want to see a sign from you.' Jesus answered and said to them, 'An evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, no sign to be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up in judgment with this generation and condemn it because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and indeed a greater than Jonah is here. The queen of the south will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and indeed a greater than Solomon is here. Friend, when we say Jesus' view of Scripture is that it was historically accurate, here's the idea. Jesus believed that what happened to Jonah happened. He believed that there was a queen of the south, that she went to see Solomon, that Solomon had great riches beyond measure. And so as I think about his view of Scripture, the things that people often mock at, a man in the belly of a whale, Jonah preaching in Nineveh, Solomon having that much wealth, the queen of Sheba, Jesus believed all of that was 100% historically accurate in his mind. Let me give you another example. Open to Matthew 24. Matthew chapter 24. Would you turn with me in your Bible? Look in verse number 36. Let me show you another way in which Jesus viewed the Scriptures as historically accurate. Matthew 12. Look, if you would, beginning in verse number 36. But of that day and hour, no one knows, talking about his final coming, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Now watch the historical accuracy. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. What does that tell me Jesus' view of Noah was? Some guy in a big boat, 350 plus years, the whole world being flooded. Jonah's a big myth. Solomon's a big myth. Noah's a big... It's not what Jesus felt. Jesus viewed the story of Noah and the ark, Jonah in the belly of the great fish, Solomon, the queen of Sheba, perfectly, historically right. Friend, here's how that helps with my view of Scripture. When I come to this book and I read about the things in the Old Testament, I read about Balaam and a donkey talking. I read about the witch of Endor. I read about Noah and the ark. I read about whatever event you may want to throw in there. Jesus viewed the Word of God as absolutely historically correct. This Bible, this book is not a book of myths. This is not a book of made-up stories that you tell to kids in VBS or Bible class or to entertain. No, Jesus viewed this as 100% accurate and right. Here's another view that I want to mention tonight. Jesus viewed the story of creation as historically and scientifically accurate. Open your Bible to Matthew chapter 19. You know, one of the stories, one of the things in the Bible that is probably assailed as much as any is the account of creation. Jesus believed it was historically and scientifically accurate. Open to Matthew 19. And I want you to see Jesus' view of that event in verses 2 through 5. Of course, Jesus here is going to discuss marriage and divorce. They come to Jesus and they ask him in verse number 2, great multitudes followed Jesus. He healed them there. Verse 3, the Pharisees came to Jesus testing him, saying to him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason? Now listen to this. Watch the answer here. Jesus answered and said to them, have you not read? He who made them at the beginning, then he quotes from Genesis 1:27, made them male and female and said, then he quotes from Genesis 2:24, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then they're no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate. Now, the main idea of the teaching there is about divorce, right? But what was the proof that Jesus offered as answer for their question? The account of Genesis 1 and the account of Genesis chapter 2. The creation of the world. The creation of Adam and Eve, male and male, male and female. The creation of man and woman in the home, leaving father and mother, be joined to your wife. Jesus believed not only that was historically accurate, but scientifically. That's the way man's origin begins. He believed the origin of man began by God supernaturally in creation. And so, again, this is how that changes my view or helps my view of Scripture. There's a lot of people today with a lot of maybe degrees behind their name who want to say the story of creation is just a myth. The idea of the whole population being created in six literal, the whole world being created in six literal 24-hour days, one man and one woman, all of that's a big myth. Jesus believed that's the way it happened. He taught that story of creation is the true origin of man. And so that changes my view of Scripture as I look to Jesus' teaching. All right, let me just mention a couple more. Jesus believed the Scripture was factually accurate and does not. The Word of God is factually accurate. Open to Matthew 22 with me for just a moment. Matthew chapter 22. Just look at two more passages with me. Matthew chapter 22. I want you to see what the Bible says. I want you to hear Jesus' words. Jesus is discussing with the Sadducees, who their whole ideology is there is no resurrection, spirit, afterlife, that kind of thinking. And so they've got this big question for Jesus. Here's a woman. She had seven husbands. They all die. She outlives them all. You say that all these ideas about the resurrection are true. We have got the best what-if question ever. Whose husband will she be in the resurrection? And Jesus says in verse 29, you're mistaken, not knowing the Scriptures nor the power of God. Jesus believed the Scriptures, that they were complete, that they gave the answer, that they were not full of error and man's ideas, but they were everything we needed to get to heaven. All right, final one, Luke chapter 16. I want to share with you another one that I think is very important. Luke chapter 16. Jesus believed that the Scripture, not something else, the Scripture is where you find everything for life and for faith. Luke chapter 16. I want you to look at the discussion beginning in verse 27. Then the man in torment said, I beg you therefore, Father, that you would send Lazarus to my father's house. I've got five brothers. I want Lazarus to go there and testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. He said, no, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they'll repent. But Jesus said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rise from the dead. What do I learn about salvation? What do I learn about helping people, working with people, trying to teach the gospel? Friend, there's sometimes when I'm studying with people that I think, what is there else I could, if we could just show them, if we could just help them see, if somehow we could. But then I realize, if people won't accept the message of the Bible, there's nothing else. That message is everything we need. That message is complete. That message has it all. And so Jesus' view of Scripture is this. is sufficient for life and for faith. You want to live a good life? You want to go to heaven? You want to share the gospel with others? You want to do the most good you can? Recognize this book is our guide. It's what we live by. It's where our hope is. Let's have the mindset that our Lord and Savior had. If you've never obeyed the gospel, friend, we want to extend that invitation to you tonight. If you're not a child of God, we're begging you tonight. Have the mindset of Jesus. Let this word prick your heart, change your life, and guide it in everything you say and do. If you're not a Christian, won't you become one tonight? Believe Jesus is God's Son. Repent of sin in your life. Confess with your mouth that He's the Savior and be immersed in water for the forgiveness of sins. If you are a Christian and maybe you're struggling with some challenges and difficulties, maybe you've got a sin in your life that is getting the best of you. Friend, God can help you. We want to help you. The Word of God can help you if you'll let it. Let God's Word break open your heart and help you tonight. We love you. God loves you. If we can help you in any way, we're begging you tonight. Won't you come as we stand and sing?
There are those here this evening who haven't had opportunity to partake the Lord's Supper. You can be dismissed this time to the small fellowship hall at the end of this wing. Our closing prayer this evening will be led by Brother Cason Stewart. Before he comes and leads us in prayer, we'll sing the first and last verse of Just Over in the Glory Land. And then after that prayer, if you'll have a seat, we'll have some additional announcements. Just Over in the Glory Land.
Soon I will home prepare where the saints are.
Just over in the glory land. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this day, and thank you for everything that you blessed us with, and thank you for the lesson that Ben brought to us tonight, and let us all take something for it and apply it to our daily walks, and be with us this week as we're at school or work, and let us live like you. In Jesus' name, amen.